Okay, from my side. So in the yesterday's class, any issues, any doubts? Any doubts in yesterday's class topic? Everything clear? So right, if you go to my YouTube channel, till yesterday class we have uploaded the videos. Okay, right, let me open this YouTube. Okay, just go to the YouTube channel, go to the YouTube first, then just in the search type SQL DBA classes. Okay, SQL DBA classes, then you can see this is our channel. Okay, with three servers will be there, like the SQL Server DBA. Just open this. Okay, and you can go to video section. Okay, this is the video section. Go to the video section, and if you go down, okay, go down, go down, go down. If you see here, from class 1, introduction to SQL Server DBA, class 1, class 2, class 3, class 4, like that. Okay, see here, class 23, introduction to pages in SQL Server, class 23. Okay, till yesterday all the videos has been uploaded earlier. Okay, so you can follow these videos. Okay, from today onwards, what and all we are going to cover, those videos also has been uploaded in the YouTube. Okay, but I am going to send the recordings from today onwards, okay, to all of you. Right, fine. Okay, Rajini, I know this is your first class. Okay, you will face some issues in understanding the topics and all. Don't worry at all. Okay, I'm going to send you the missing classes. Okay, or else you can simply access all the classes from the beginning from this YouTube channel. Okay, so if you have any issues, just update me. Okay, yeah, thank you, Rajini.
Thank you.
Right, so yesterday we have discussed about the pages, right? So can anyone tell me how many system pages will be there in SQL Server?
6 pages.
Sorry?
6 system pages are there.
Okay, what and all system pages we have?
Global allocation map and okay. Insert global allocation map.
Okay.
Page free space, PFS and IAM, DCM and DCM.
Very good. So can anyone tell me what PFS page will do?
It will record the information about page allocation of free space available on the pages.
Very good. Excellent. And what DCM page will do?
It record about extent of have changed things last full backup database statement.
Very good. What IAM page will do?
IAM page.
It will store all the exchange information.
That's it?
Yeah, that are associated with
a
single object.
Very good. Okay, that are associated with a single object. It will store all the extents information that are associated with a single object. Good. Right. What BCM page will do?
It will store the information about which extent modified by the bulk operations.
Mm-hmm.
What are the things last backup of log statement.
Right. Very good. So can anyone tell me what is the first page of first file? 1:1.
PFS page.
Very good. PFS page?
1:1.
1:1 PFS page?
Second is GAM.
Okay.
Third is GAM.
Okay. Okay, fine, good. And what is the 9th page of a database?
Page.
Which page?
Boot page.
What kind of information will be stored in the boot page?
Like database version name. Compatibility levels and last backup and
okay.
Last DBC check DB.
Very good.
All the information.
So how many boot pages will exist per database?
Only one for database.
Very good. What if my boot page is corrupted? How to fix it?
We cannot restore it.
Okay. So I have to do a full backup restore, then only I can fix the boot page issue, right? Right. How many extents information will be tracked by a single GAMP page? How many extents information will be tracked by a single GAMP page?
64,000.
Very good. Okay, 64,000 extents information will be tracked by a single GAMP page. Can anyone tell me what is the query we are going to use to see the page, internals of the page?
DBCC tram trace on
3604. Okay.
DBCC trace on 3604. And DBCC page like you have to.
Okay. DBCC page command. Okay. Fine. DBCC page command. Database name.
Database
name. Table name. Okay.
Table name. Page ID.
Page ID.
Display options. Okay, fine. Very good. Okay, how many data pages are there in SQL Server? How many data pages? How many types of? How many types of? Yeah.
Eight.
How many types of data? Eight or three?
Three.
Eight. Types of pages. Eight.
Data pages.
Data pages. Okay. Types of data pages. Okay, fine. And very good. Okay, so right, you know, right, so this diagram, okay, very important. So in SQL Server, again, instances, or else remove this in SQL Server. In the instances, okay, instance is nothing but collection, sorry, one SQL Server software copy is called one instance. Okay, one SQL Server software copy is called one instance. In the instance, you will have database. In the database, you will have file groups and log files, right? And again, if you go inside the file groups, you will have data files. We have two types of data files, MDF file and NDF file. MDF means master data file, NDF means next data file or new data file. If you go inside the data files, you can see extents. Okay, if you go inside the extents, you can see pages, right? So page is a basic storage unit of a data file. Whenever you are creating any object like table, views, stored procs, any objects, they are going to create on a single page. Okay, if your object is big, SQL Server will allocate you another page, right? So page is a basic storage unit, whereas extent is a basic allocation unit of a data file, right? So can anyone tell me why page size is 8 KB?
It is more than eight. We will get some performance issues.
Okay. Okay.
It is difficult to load all pages.
Sorry, it is difficult to load all the pages. Okay, very
all
good. Yes. Very
and it
good.
Takes more time to read inside the numbers.
Very good. Excellent. Good. So that's why, okay, there is no specific reason for the page size is 8 KB. But if the page size is too big, it will take time to load the same page inside the memory, means RAM. If the page is too small, lot of pages has to be loaded inside the memory, which again cause the performance issues. So Microsoft decided an intermediate value, not too big, not too small. So they just decided to fix the data page size as 8 KB. Okay, data page size as 8 KB. Fine, very good. Okay, so these things and all we have discussed yesterday, right? Fine. So today we'll discuss about the log file architecture. Yesterday we have completed data file architecture, right? We have discussed about the file groups, we have discussed about the files, we have discussed about the extents, we have discussed about the pages. Okay, so now we'll discuss about the log file. What is the use of the log file first? why we should have two files for a database, what it will do, okay, if what will happen if there is no log file. Yes, any answer? Someone is trying to say the answer, right? Fine, we'll discuss about the log file. Before going to the log file architecture, can anyone tell me how a page look likes? What are the portions will be there in the page? Page, inside the page, inside the page. Any keywords? Eight portions.
Eight portions.
Eight portions. Okay, what are those eight portions? Okay, so we will have only three portions, okay, not eight portions. Page header, right? Page header, yes, data, and this is your data, okay? Page header, data, and row offset, okay? So yesterday we have seen, right, how to open a page, how to see the row offset. Row offset will store the address of each record. Page header will store the page ID, allocation ID, okay? Allocation ID means what? Table allocation ID will be there, right? Table allocation ID. So this kind of metadata information will be stored in the page header, right? We'll discuss about the log file. So what is the use of the log file? What if we don't have log file, right? So I'll tell you, log file is very, very important, okay? Every transaction you're creating a database, creating an object, creating any other things, okay? Every transaction, creating, updating, insert, deletes, every transaction, first it will go inside the log file, okay? First it will go inside the log file. Why we should have this log file and all, I'll tell you, right? So every database should have consistency, right? Every database should have consistency, right? Say for example, the best example, if you are going to send a money to me, if you people are going to send money to me, imagine you people are sending, okay, 20,000 rupees to me, okay? So the transaction is 20,000 rupees. What is the result of this transaction? Either it should success or else it should fail, right? There is nothing like partial success in this transaction, like 10,000 coming to my account, 10,000 will be, okay, like back to your account, nothing like that, right? Either I'll get full 20,000 rupees or else I'll get 0 rupees. Means either the transaction is completely successful or else the transaction is completely failed. There is nothing like a partial success of this transaction. Imagine you are inserting 1 lakh records. 10,000 records successfully inserted, right? You know, right, how inserts will happen, you know, right? It will start with a begin tran, okay? It will start with a begin tran, right? And you are simply inserting insert into values, okay? Something like, okay, S number, to insert into table name, right? Imagine the table name is student. Student values 1, comma Shanmukh, okay? Right, so this is the transaction and you are running this for 1 lakh times, go 1 lakh, okay? And at the end of the transaction you will have commit. Imagine this is a single statement. Of course you have a lot of 1 lakh different transactions are there, okay? 1 lakh different transactions are there. Just to understand, I just gave only one transaction here, right? So you are running this transaction 1 lakh times, okay? Means 1 lakh records are going to be inserted now, right? So 10,000 transaction completed, fine. Commit, when it will occur? Commit after completing the 1 lakh transaction, then only the final statement is commit, right? Till 1 lakh transaction is going to commit, till the 1 lakh transaction is going to insert, commit will not be committed on the database, right? So if you want to run this commit, what it will do? It will permanently save the transactions. See, log file is a temporary storage. Data file is a permanent storage. Okay, first every transaction will go to the log file only. Each transaction will go to the log file only. Then it will save the transaction temporarily in the log file. Then once commit happened, the transaction, means we cannot say the transaction here. This is the transaction, right? This is the transaction. What is the data in this transaction? Okay, 1 comma Shanmukh is the data. 1 comma Shanmukh, okay, is the data. So this is the whole transaction, and this is the data. This records only are going to insert in the student table, right? This record is only going to insert in the student table. So whenever commit occurs, automatically the whole transaction will be saved in the, usually the whole transaction first it will go to the log file first. Once the commit occurs, the data that is there in the transaction will move to the data file. Data file means permanently storage area. Okay, in the data file you are going to store the data permanently. Okay, so till the data is going to save in the data file permanently, the data will be stored, the transaction will be stored in the log file temporarily. Why it will store the transaction temporarily? It can directly write the 1 lakh transactions to the data file, right? Why again we should have a log file? Then imagine you are running 1 lakh transactions, 10,000 transactions completed, 20,000 completed, 30,000 completed, 40, 50, 60, 70, 90, 99,900 transactions completed. Okay, 99,900 transactions has been completed. Suddenly something happened to the server. Your server is down, your server is crashed, or database is down, database went into offline. But still 100 transactions are there to complete. Once this 100 transactions has been completed, then only commit will run, right? Once this 100 transactions has been completed. Why? Because commit will be there at the end of the 1 lakh transaction. But as of now, 99,900 transactions only completed. Still 100 transactions are pending. Once this 100 transactions also completed, then commit will run at the end of the 1 lakh transaction. But unfortunately, your database is down at 99,900. Then what is the status of this transaction? Imagine if there is no log file, you're directly storing the data to the data file. Data file, you cannot directly store the data to the data file, right? You have to apply the commit. But the commit is there at the end of the 1 lakh transaction. So unfortunately, commit didn't run in this case. So the data will not go to the data file. What if you have log file? Log file will store all these transactions in the log file temporarily. If something happened to the database, once the database come online, once the database is back, or else once the server is back, based on the transactions, it will do roll back or roll forward. What is this roll back, roll forward? Roll back means undo, and roll forward means redo. Okay, undo. Undo means, you know, right, cancel the transaction. Redo means again it will do the transaction from the beginning. Got it? So depends upon the requirement. Say for example, 99,900 transactions has been completed, but the whole sequence is not committed transaction. So once the database is online, once the database is back, once the server is back, as the transactions has been already stored in the log file, again, it will do the rollback of all the 99,900 transactions. Then again, it will start the transaction from the beginning. Means again, it will start inserting all 1 lakh. Again, in this case, rollback will happen first, then roll forward will happen next, to make sure the data is consistent across the database. Imagine if you don't have log file, what is the issue? There is no rollback, roll forward concept. If the server is down in the middle of the transactions, we are going to lose the data, right? If there is no log file, there is no concept of rollback and roll forward. If any transactions are happening, if something happened to the server, if the server is offline, or again, once the server is back again, but if there is no log file, if the data is not going to store that, the transactions are not going to store in the log file temporarily, what happened is, again, we are going to lose the data. So the database is not going to consistent. Okay, to achieve the ACID properties in the SQL server, we have ACID properties. ACID means what? Atomicity, consistency, sorry, isolation and durability. Okay, to achieve these four properties, SQL Server, Microsoft introduced this log file. The main usage of the log file is during the transaction, if something happened to the database or server, either the transactions has to be rollbacked or else the transaction has to be rolled forward. If the transactions has been directly stored inside the database, then that will be a problem. It cannot do rollback or roll forward. Okay, so that's why they introduced one more file called log file. In that log file, all the transaction, any transaction, first it will go to log file only. Okay, any transaction you are running on a database, first it will go to log file only. Then once you run the commit or once SQL Server applied commit, then only the transaction will, the data, not the transaction. Data means, you know, right? So the transaction is like this, okay? And the data means here. Only this data will go to the, okay, data file, and remaining this transaction will be stay inside the log file only. Okay, so once the commit is happened, then what happened is the log file is going to be truncated automatically. Don't think like the transaction. Can you please mute it? If you don't have any questions, right? Yeah. Any questions? Right. Okay, fine. So the log file, I told you, right, the transactions, remember, whenever I'm saying log file, in the log files transactions are going to be saved. Whenever I'm saying the data file, in the data file only data is going to be stored. Okay, don't confuse log file, transactions, data file, only data, right? So the transactions are going to store in the log file temporary basis, not permanent basis, right? So once the data is completely committed to the data file, okay, once the data is completely committed, once this record has been moved to data file, then this transaction will be truncated automatically from the log file. Okay, log file will be truncated automatically in a regular intervals. Log file will be truncated automatically. Okay, this is the normal behavior of the log file. We can change this normal behavior. We have different recovery models, in full recovery model, differential bulk logged recovery model, and simple recovery model. In these three recovery models, the behavior of the log file is going to change, but the actual behavior is it is going to store the log file. The log file is going to store the transactions temporarily. Once commit is happened, it is going to move the data from the log file to the data file permanently. Once the data is committed, the transactions that are there in the log file has been truncated automatically. If something happened to the database during the, in the middle of the, okay, transactions, log file is going to achieve the database consistency by doing rollback or roll forward of the transactions. This is what a log file will do. Any questions, any doubts?
What is the default log file size?
Default log, I'll tell you, okay? What is the default log? Usually it depends upon the initial size, okay? Usually whenever you're creating any new database, depends upon the model database log file. If the model database log file is 1 MB, the default log file is also going to be created with 1 MB for all the databases. If the model database log file size is 100 MB, whenever you're creating a new database, it will automatically took the 100 MB as a log file default size. Okay, initial size, it depends upon the initial size of the log file. Again, the initial size will depend on the model database. I told you, right, model database will act as a template for the newly created databases. So the log file size of each database will decide on the model database log file. Whenever you're creating, once you just created the log database, that means data file and log file will be created, right? So depends upon the data you're inserting, the log file is going to grow. Auto growth will be there, right? If you enable the auto growth, the log file is going to grow. Got it? So maximum, what is the max size of the log file? What is the max size of the log file? Can anyone tell me? There is no maximum size of a data file. Okay, data file depends upon the storage you have.
You can increase the data file, it will increase, it will grow automatically, but there is a limit for the log file size. Up to what maximum level it can grow your log file? Up to, okay, 2 TB only your log file can grow. Up to 2 TB, okay? Right. So in the interview, sometimes they will ask you a tricky question. My log file size is 3 TB. I am trying to shrink the log file. I am unable to shrink the log file. What is the wrong in this question?
3 TB.
Okay. So the log file can grow up to 2 TB. Okay. It cannot grow more than 2 TB. This is fixed. The log file, max log file size is 2 TB only. Right. It cannot grow. Once this 2 TB has been completely full, then depends upon the transactions. Any transactions are committed, then that committed transactions are going to be truncated automatically from your log file. Okay, so usually log file is very important. Okay, so like if there is no free space in the log file, why? Because log file, every transaction, first it will touch the log file, right? First they are going to insert into the log file, right? So if there is no free space in the log file, then the application will be stopped. Okay, so make sure there is a proper free space in the log file. In the organization, we are going to maintain a separate drive for data files and separate drive for log files. Okay, data files will be there in the data drives and log files will be there in the log drive. Okay, so they are going to maintain a separate drive. You can put in a single drive also, but suddenly if huge data came, the drive that are associated with the log files, okay, are going to full, right? So again application will be stopped. So that's why usually, okay, they are going to maintain a separate drives for data file and log files. So sometimes usually the log files will be small only, but whenever the data is coming from the application, the log file will grow like anything, and again it will be very difficult to truncate the log file manually. We have to do a lot of things, okay? If you want to shrink it, it will be very difficult thing, and we have to check what exactly it is running on the log file and all. Okay, right? So if you want to see the log file free space and all, there is a query. Okay, sometimes in the organizations you are going to get your log file full. Very regularly you will get this error. Very regularly you are going to get this error. Okay, the log file is full, 9002. Okay, our log file crosses more than 90%. So what is the solution for that? You have to shrink the log file. Usually, okay, the log file is going to shrink automatically, but sometimes it is not going to shrink automatically. I'll tell you why, in which case the log file is not going to shrink automatically. I'm unable to connect to my SQL server. Can anyone troubleshoot this issue? Why I'm unable to connect to the SQL server? Okay, I'm getting this error. Can anyone tell me the possible reasons why I'm unable to connect to the SQL server?
It is not in the port set, the server.
Okay, it is not in the
port set.
Okay.
It is not running in the backend.
Okay. SQL server is not running. That is one reason. And what and all other reasons we cannot connect to the SQL server? Okay, so if you don't have enough permissions and all, in such case also, okay, you cannot connect to the SQL server. And if you are, see, you have a separate domain, okay, for example, imagine like this, okay, you are working for TCS company and you are trying to connect to the Infosys server, okay, Infosys server. In such case also you cannot connect, but again the server will be up and running. Means if there are different domains, you have to connect through the proper domain only. Otherwise, you are going to get the connection issues and all, right? In this case, my SQL server is not up and running. So I'm going to check whether the services are up and running or not. Sometimes, okay, you will get an issue with the port numbers as well. Okay, the port numbers that are associated with the SQL. What is the default port number for a default instance? Can anyone tell me what is the default port number of a default instance?
1433.
Very good. Okay, so this point we have discussed during the we didn't discuss during the installation, but port number will be there for every instance. There will be one port number. Port number means simply which will listen the connections. Okay, port is nothing but port. Sorry, port is nothing but a connection which will listen. Okay, a port means an endpoint. Endpoint which will listen the connections. So it is very important for a default instance, the default port number is 1433, and for a named instance and all, automatically dynamic ports are going to be allocated by SQL Server. You can change the ports from the configuration manager. I'll tell you how to change the ports. Okay, in this case I am trying to connect to the server, MS SQL Server, which is in stopped state. You can see, right, currently it is not running. Okay, if you see here, it is started. As of now, it is not showing any status. Remaining other services are showing as started, but this is not showing any status. Simply what you have to do, either select this one, you can click on the start button, or else right click on this service and you can click on the start button. Right now this is running. Okay, so just connect to the SQL Server now, Management Studio, and connect. Okay, the meeting is going to close now. It is showing less than 1 minute. Okay, Rajni. So for every 40 minutes, our meeting is going to close. Okay, I'll open the meeting link again immediately. Okay, just try to join. Okay, with the same link. Okay. Yeah, thank you all. I'm going to reopen the meeting link again.